1330 WEBY, Northwest Florida's Talk Radio. This is your turn, a live call-in show featuring spirited discussion and debate about issues that matter to the community. Stay with us to hear what Northwest Florida thinks. Better yet, call in at 623-1330 and tell us what you think. It's your turn here on 1330 WEBY, Northwest Florida's Talk Radio. Now, here's the host of Your Turn.
Thank you so much for tuning in. My name's Renee Giachino. I'm corporate counsel for the Center for Individual Freedom, and I'm hosting this version of Your Turn, the program that I've dubbed Meeting Nonsense with Common Sense. To learn more about my organization, you can find us on the web at www.cfif.org. Well, it is my extreme pleasure to welcome back to the program one of my favorite authors. It's taken a little while to have him back on simply because a book like this takes a little while to finish. This is the Volume 2, and I am welcoming back Andrew Oak. Andrew Oak, folks know him as the First Ladies Man. If you happen to be seated at a computer, you can pull up his website and follow along with us, firstladiesman.com, firstladiesman.com. And he authored the book, The First Ladies. As you know it, folks, it's unusual for their time, On the Road with America's First Ladies. And Volume 2 just came out just a couple of weeks ago, just in time for the holidays. Will make a fabulous stocking stuffer. In fact, hopefully my daughter isn't listening because there will be one in hers. She loved the first volume so much. I'm sure she will enjoy the second as well. Andrew, welcome back to Your Turn. Thanks for joining me again.
Renee, it's so great to have to be back on the show and have this next book in as people I've flattered and humbled, they were ready for it. Folks like your daughter enjoyed Volume 1 so much, and Volume 2 was twice as much fun to write as the first, so I'm happy to have it out here with you.
Easier or harder? Well, let me start by saying it sounds like Volume 2 didn't start out quite too well. I guess if you talk about hauling luggage and equipment and cameras through New York City from a train station to a rental car place, kind of a rough start for Volume 2, but you made it through. As we age, we start to enjoy things. Some things do get better with age, like wine. Is that true in doing a Volume 2?
Well, it's funny because I thought, Volume 1 was the first book I'd ever written off of this series that these women just spoke to me so dearly and fell engrossed in their lives, and the access that I got for the C-SPAN series was so incredible that I couldn't stop talking about them, and I thought I really had things down and had a format that would just be sort of plugging in, Volume 2, the different ladies, and it was a struggle. Volume 2 was harder, and not just for the reason you mentioned. Edith Roosevelt starts off. Volume 1 is the 1700s and 1800s, concludes with the McKinley administration, the assassination of McKinley. Volume 2 picks up with Edith Roosevelt and goes all the way up through my impressions thus far of Melania Trump, so brings us into modern times. But the Roosevelt estate out on Long Island in Oyster Bay was closed down because of repairs and renovations. Mm-hmm. So it was a real hiccup to get started, and in the middle of season two was the government shutdown in October,
right,
of 2013. So it was just a different animal altogether, and the book was the same. Sitting down and just hammering it out, I thought maybe I'd have more time in between Volume 1 and Volume 2, but like I say, flatteringly so, the demand was so great for the book that I hopped right on it. So 2 years and two books later, I'm back here, I think, for the third time on with you, and it's always great to be on with you because I know you read through this book so thoroughly and you do know the stories and you're right in step with me on this, so it's a lot of fun.
Well, it's definitely a fun read, and I love how you mix it up. It's not just, obviously we want to learn a lot about these first ladies. I mean, we want to, quote, remember the ladies in the words of Abigail Adams.
Certainly.
Mrs. Abigail Adams. We definitely need to remember the ladies, and there's no one better than to tell their story than you as the expert on the first ladies. But I love how you weave in a little bit of your background, your story, your food knowledge, your own, and give your own spin even to some of these areas, that you've had the opportunity to visit. Speaking of areas you've had the opportunity to visit, I understand you kept a map with pushpins.
Yeah, at my desk. It's sort of, I'm a visual person. I need my calendar and my phone is great, and it sends me the electronic reminders and all the things of modern conveniences, but I need a physical calendar where I can write things down. I need a map to know where I'm going. And when you pinball all across the United States, especially more so in Volume 2, as our country grows and we start to spread out and go west of the Mississippi and even all the way out to the West Coast for some first ladies, I really needed that centering, that grounding. But as far as the structure of the book and relating things to myself and my own life and my travels and my past adventures and projects, I didn't have a choice to write it any other way. I write the way I speak, and people seem to enjoy my stories and my public events and speeches. So when it came time to write these books, it just seemed to make sense to make it sort of there's a history lesson there for sure. That's inescapable. You can't avoid that, nor should you. And then you get a little bit of behind the scenes of what it's like to put together a television series. And then you get where did I eat and where did I stay and what were sort of the trials and tribulations and road bumps along the journey. And it just makes for a fun kind of travelogue while remembering these ladies who were absolutely partners hand in hand in building this great country of ours. And growing up outside of Washington, D.C., as I did in suburban Maryland, literally, 20 minutes from downtown Washington, D.C., I was surprised how little I knew about these ladies and what I was not taught in history class and what we didn't know about them from going to the Smithsonian and the museums and stuff. But it's not an exaggeration to say that we would not be a country at all, let alone the country we are, if we had not had these extraordinary women as partners continuing all the way up into modern times.
Right. You wrote at one point in the book, without their wives, these men would more likely not have been presidents, which is a pretty powerful statement. Who do you believe you've now gone through? And I do have a question. I feel like I'm ADD in this interview because I'm going to be all over the place, but I'm going to try to come back to my initial questions. But in terms of when you've looked at the different wives, one of the things that you also noted in there is that there have been more first ladies than there have been presidents. Help me understand that.
Yeah, it's interesting. Some of these presidents did not have wives as first ladies. To give some modern relevance to that, some people are not pleased that Ivanka Trump has a position in her father's White House as an advisor. You can go to the third administration of our country's history. Thomas Jefferson did not have a wife. He was a widower, 20 years before he got in. Van Buren, Jackson, those are just some of the presidents, Buchanan, that didn't have a wife while they were in the White House. So they had nieces, daughters, sisters step in and perform these duties. And then there were the presidents, of which there are, I think it's three now, that had more than one wife. John Tyler had more than one wife because his first wife dies. In more modern times, Woodrow Wilson had two wives because his first wife died in the White House. She's the last, hopefully, of three first ladies that would die in the White House. And these presidents remarried. And in between their marriages, they had women stand in to perform hostessing duties. So there are a lot more women that sit in the role of first lady or official White House hostess than there are president. And a lot of people, because the most recent of those is Wilson in the early 19-teens, for this to happen, his first wife, Ellen, died of Bright's disease, a kidney disease, and she's actually the first lady that designed the Rose Garden. So a first lady, a wife of a president that we don't even remember when we're remembering first ladies or this president's first ladies, mm-hmm. is the reason why we have the Rose Garden, where we see modern day presidents almost weekly. So to discover that the influence that these women that we don't even remember had on modern times was just remarkable at every turn, when these women became these real people who lived, laughed, loved, lost, cried, celebrated. They stepped off the pages of history books and out of oil paintings and became these real people to me that I now write and speak about beyond the C-SPAN series that was such a joy and honor to work on.
You know, some of the first ladies need no last name. You know, we know who we're talking about, from Jackie to Hillary to, mm-hmm. to even Martha, Mary Todd, which I didn't know she didn't like to use her last name, Todd, but you know, Mary Todd will say that anyway. And
sure.
then I'm embarrassed to admit that if you had said to me, Ellen, Edith, Florence, Grace, and Lou, I would have said, Lou who? To every one of them.
Yeah.
Wow, it's embarrassing. You know, as you said, you know, it, just a couple minutes ago, learning about how little we knew about these ladies who had such huge roles. I mean, they shared, as you said, you've said, you know, they shared beds, many of them, with the most powerful, arguably the most powerful man, you know, to date, man in the country, you know, or in the world, even for that matter. Andrew, I've got to take a quick break. I've got you scheduled
sure.
for the whole time. I hope you can stay with me for another
Absolutely.
15 minutes, because I do want to come back to, I'm going to tease this a little. Without their wives, these men would more likely not have been presidents. And I want to ask you, if you'll give your opinion, who is that most true for and least true for? So we're going to come back
Renee,
and
for sure.
get Andrew's opinion on that. We are talking with Andrew Oak. He's the first ladies' man. He is the author of a book. Actually, it's now got two volumes, Unusual for Their Time, On the Road with America's First Ladies. Volume one has been out for a while, an incredible read. Volume two just came out, takes us from Edith Roosevelt to Melania Trump. We'll be right back with Andrew. Please stay tuned.
Now, back to your turn on 1330 WEBY, Northwest Florida's Talk Radio. The phone lines are open, so call in and join the conversation at 623-1330.
We are back with the first ladies' man. Yes, you know him as Andrew Oak. Some folks might even know him as a funny little dude, at least his 10-year-old self was. If you want to know what I'm talking about, you got to read the book. You got to read the book, Unusual for Their Time, On the Road with America's First Ladies. I know you all have seen him on television. Now read his volume two, Unusual for Their Time. Read volume one if you haven't, but certainly pick up as well volume two. All right, in the book you write, without their wives, these men would more likely not have been president. Who is that most true for? And
well,
I know I'm not asking you to disparage a president, but sure. go ahead.
Of course. Well, you know, it's true for so many of these men in that we were talking during the break, you know, back in the 1700s and 1800s, a home, a plantation, a farm was a corporation. It was such a business, and these women ran these businesses, and that's why I say that the country wouldn't be America if George Washington had married anyone other than Martha, because Martha had to run this powerful and prominent estate. So George could go out and start a revolution and be the general that he was and get us to the point where we are could stand on our own. But in more modern times, I think this is not a stretch to say that Taft would not have been president if it not for his wife Helen. She was a driving force behind much of his career. He was a judge in Ohio, in Cincinnati, and all he wanted to be was a judge. And he ended up to be a judge. He was the only president to become a Supreme Court justice. And he had a deal with President McKinley that he was going to go and get things straightened for the U.S. in the Philippines. And when he came back, he was securing himself a seat. Well, McKinley's nation so dies his deal for Supreme Court justice. So when he comes back, the Republican Party wanted them to replace the task to replace Theodore Roosevelt, who was not running again. He decides to run and becomes the Bull Moose Party, and that's a whole other story together. But Helen Taft was the driving force. When she was a teenager, you know, kids will go, I know I did, on spring breaks and summer breaks, they'll send you to camp or send you to go stay with a relative and get you out of your parents' hair for a while. Well, the Heron, her name was Helen Heron before she was married, Helen's father, his former law partner, was Rutherford B. Hayes. So when Helen Taft or Helen Heron gets sent for spring break to go stay with her uncle Rutherford, it's at the White House in Washington, D.C., and a 12, 13, 14-year-old Helen Heron thought, well, I could get used to this. I want to live here. So when position came to be that Taft was lined up to possibly be the next president, she was pushing for it and pushing for him to not worry about the governorships and the Supreme Court justice seats, and drove him into the White House. So it's just one example. And the great thing about Helen Taft is in 90% of the rooms I speak in, people agree, myself included, that if you were naming 5, 10, 15, 20 first ladies, Helen Taft would not be on that list. We were talking earlier about women that we needed a first and last name, or some that we didn't even know their first name, had to be reminded by these lists. And Helen Taft is the first lady to donate an inauguration gown to the Smithsonian. So the thing that is front and foremost and number one answer for people across the country when I say, what's the number one thing you think of when you think about first ladies? They say the dresses. So the image that we think of for these powerful women is the dress, and it's donated by a woman that we wouldn't even remember or think of if we were listing 5, 10, 15, 20 first ladies.
Hmm. It's almost embarrassing, but we won't leave it at that. All right, the least true. Who is that? Now, I know some of them obviously never married, as we already talked about. So we will take them out of the equations. But without their wives, these men would more likely not have been presidents. I mean, we know that some of them certainly, you know, in earlier times, didn't come to the White House, didn't want to come to the White House, very rarely even came to the White House. So, you know, but that doesn't mean they didn't help get them there. As you even write about someone like, who was it? Maybe it was Edith Roosevelt, you know, who stayed home, took care of the home, raised the children, paid the bills, intense bookkeeping. If it weren't for her, he couldn't have been campaigning. He couldn't have been out there on the road, couldn't have been president, quite frankly.
100%. I think, you know, these women are arguably the most powerful and influential unpaid and unelected women in the world. And they are they happen to be married to a man who becomes president. And some of the women, like we talked about with Helen Taft, are that driving force behind it. And I'm going to bring up just the most recent presidency, President Trump. The relationship has been speculated, why Trump ran, and did Trump want to win, and was he in this for good? And there he sits in the White House, and he is president. And a lot of people have said that Melania Trump wanted nothing to do with the White House, wanted nothing to do with First Lady. She was happy in New York. That's why she didn't move down here. She didn't move down here because she wanted her son to finish school. And the whole role of mother and First Lady is something that I write about throughout in the book. We can go back to the Garfields and the Clevelands and the both Roosevelts and in modern times, the Carters, the Clintons, the Bushes, the Obamas, and Kennedys, and now the Trumps are raising a younger child in the White House, and this is always very, very popular in the public eye, and she was criticized for doing what she thought was right for her son. Now, keep in mind, again, these women, unpaid and unelected, you can't tell a woman how to be a mother. You can't tell a man how to be a father. You can't tell parents how to raise children, whether they're in the White House or not, mm-hmm. but certainly not a woman that's not in an elected or paid role. So I support what Melania did. A lot of people say that Trump was going to run with or without Melania's advice or help or this, and it's been recently written in a number of places that it was almost Melania Trump sort of daring her husband to run, because she said in the number of articles I've read and sources that I've talked to, they say that Trump's been making noise about this for so long, Melania Trump finally said, look, do it. You say you've been doing it. You're not going to be happy till you do it, whether you want to win, whether you're serious, not going to run, going to run. You keep saying it. You're not going to be happy until you try. So, you know, it's the relationship that these women have professionally. I mean, one of the most astounding and staggering is you go back to Abigail Adams, you mentioned before with Remember the Ladies. But in a letter that John Adams wrote to Abigail Adams, he asked her for advice. Should I run for president? And her only advice at that point was, look, run for president if you want to, but I'm not going to sit under another president other than George Washington. So come back president or just come home. She didn't want another term as second lady. Mm-hmm. She thought either leave politics behind or come home number one, and he came home number one. It's remarkable to think that these women have been influencing their husbands' professional lives from the very beginning, because it's just not the picture we have of them. It's not the image we've been given in history class. And then if you think of these women as these equal political partners and advisors all the way through from the beginning, then things like the Reagan start to sound kind of weird. You know, I'm old enough to remember when President Reagan said something to the effect of, I don't make any decisions without running Nancy, it by Nancy.
Right.
And people went crazy for that. They thought, man, they blasted him in the press. And then you fast forward not too far in the future after that, and Clinton campaign saying, you get two for one. That's another remarkable thing to study throughout all of this, is the short-term memory and the hypocritical nature of the public, the American public, that what is good for one is not always good for the next. It's the same thing with Melania Trump and protecting your child, you know, and saying, well, I want him to be able to finish the school year and not move to D.C. And the people that detracted and criticized her for that were not standing first in line to commend her and praise her for doing exactly what she said she was going to do. I mean, they flat out called her a liar. They said she's not moving to D.C. This is just garbage. She's never going to come here. She doesn't want to come here. And then she comes here, and for all intents and purposes, she's embracing the role from what I see. I mean, you know, she got a lot of grief for wearing high heels to walk to the helicopter for the hurricane in Houston. What people don't realize is that in the past two administrations, we've seen massive hurricanes and natural disasters in the Bush and the Obama administration. Laura Bush, Michelle Obama, wildly popular first ladies. They didn't go to natural disasters and hurricanes every time, if at all.
Right.
Mrs. Obama wasn't there walking on the beach with Christie and President Obama.
Right.
And no one criticized her for that. Yet Melania Trump goes and does what the past few first ladies have not done. And she gets criticized for the shoes she's wearing. It's really, really, really interesting to compare and contrast how these women have been portrayed and the public image that they've gotten throughout the years.
And you do it fantastically. Folks, the book is called Unusual for Their Time, On the Road with America's First Ladies. You can get Volume 1 and Volume 2 in a complete set. Check them out at firstladiesman.com. We've already secured Andrew to come back at Valentine's Day to talk with us about the love affair between some of them. We're going to have him back at Mother's Day to talk about the first ladies raising their children. Andrew, thank you for writing this book, and thank you for your time this afternoon. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you, Renee. Any and every time. Great to be